the scriptures this morning. Come on up. Plenty good room. Romans chapter 11. So you wonder why we have junior church. Just to get rid of the kids so they can have their seats. You know, when we first started our church more than 10 years ago now, we had gotten from somebody a bunch of steel folding chairs, metal folding chairs. And I didn't mind them at all until the first time I sat in one. And, you know, it didn't take us very long to get some decent seats to sit in. I remember we had I think, about 60 folding chairs, had about 10 people. And when we started our church, I was the only piano player. And I was the song leader. It was kind of weird leading songs from the piano. And then I was preaching. And so I didn't have any problem with the chairs at all. I never sat in them. But then I had someone teach Sunday school one day. I thought, these things are absolutely terrible. So we got chairs right away. It's amazing how the Lord provided for that. Romans chapter 11. Good to see you here this morning. Are you happy to be here today?
Amen. Amen.
Do you believe that God has something for you?
Amen.
I do. You know, I just am always amazed at how that God knows exactly what the needs of each individual is, and how God's Holy Spirit, God's Word, are always, always able to supply that need. So as we go to the Word of God here this morning, let's be mindful of that as we read our text. I want to read three verses, actually, in Romans 11, because I want to preach a good portion of this chapter. For sake of time, we can't read as much as we are going to preach here this morning. So I'd like to read three key verses that ask and answer the question that really is our focus for this morning. Verse 1, if you will, please, we'll read verse 1, verse 11, and verse 25. I say then, hath God cast away his people? God forbid. For I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. And then, if you will, look at verse 11. I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid. But rather, through their fall, salvation is come unto the Gentiles, for to provoke them to jealousy. And then verse 25. For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentile be come in. I'd like to read verse 26, even though it's part of next week's message. Verse 26, the Bible says, and so all Israel shall be saved, and, I'm sorry, as it is written, there shall come out of Zion the Deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. Let's ask for God to help us this morning, shall we? Father, this morning we do need your help. Lord, we do not need to hear words of man's wisdom. We don't need to hear man's opinions. We need to hear from you, specifically, God, from you, what you want to say to us. And so we ask for your Holy Spirit to speak to us through your word this morning. Father, even though so many events are going on in every individual's life that's here today, I ask that you would help to give us quietness of spirit for this hour. I pray that you would help us to have hungry hearts that are eager to hear and to listen. Lord, that you would grant us alertness, focus, and then, Father, more than anything else, I ask that the truth of the Scripture would make its way to our lives, to our hearts, and that we would be able to receive it and be changed by it today. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're in the midst of, if you haven't been with us, in the midst of our series in Romans, and I don't know about you, but I feel like when we get done, I want to preach it again. There's nothing as thrilling as getting into the Word of God and getting to understand how clearly, simply written, important biblical truth is. And honestly, I believe that for most Christians, a lot of the questions that we have are answered just very, very directly in Romans. It's sad, but it's often true that I've noted that most believers don't really know the contents of Romans in its entirety. In other words, if you ask somebody, what's Romans about? Everyone can quote verses from Romans, right? Let's try it. Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. How about Romans 5:8? But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 10:13. For whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Most Christians know those verses, don't they? As a matter of fact, sometimes those are one of the few verses that individuals who are not yet believers have actually read, maybe do not have committed to memory, but have actually read because we put them in gospel tracts a lot of times. I'm going to turn the volume down just a little bit if you'll bear with me for a second. It's just a little too loud there. Is that better? Those are verses that many believers have memorized as part of the Romans Road plan to salvation. Don't misunderstand me here this morning. I'm not being critical of that way of sharing the gospel. I do believe for any person who wants to know for sure how simple the gospel is and know for sure what God says is the way to get to heaven, I think there's nothing like John chapter 3, when Jesus explains to Nicodemus that he must be born again. And in a nutshell, Jesus boils down the simplicity of salvation with the illustration of being born spiritually. Every person's born physically, but every person needs to be born spiritually, don't we? Good job, by the way. Sometimes I forget to congratulate you on your physical birth. But it looks like you've all been born here this morning, and you've done a fine job of it. I don't see any unborn here this morning. Do we have anyone that's unborn in here this morning yet? We went through that in November, didn't we? We had like five of them. And but everybody's been born, and you've done a fine job about it. And it looks like it's thoroughly done. You're born. You say, Pastor, why congratulate me on my physical birth? Well, because I want to point out to you the irony, actually, of being born again and what Jesus was explaining to Nicodemus when he said, you must be born again. See, he wanted Nicodemus to understand every person is born physically without any kind of a choice of their own. But in order to see the kingdom of God, as Jesus put it, that was what Nicodemus was desirous of, every person had to be born again. And Nicodemus had come to Jesus as a wise Pharisee who was a ruler of the Jews, respected among his peers, and one who knew the law. He had come to Jesus to inquire how to know for sure that he was going to see the kingdom of God. It's amazing to me when you look at the academic education a good Pharisee would have to have. You realize that a good Pharisee probably would have had the first five books of the Bible memorized, word for word. And when it comes to being an expert about the Bible and about God, a Pharisee, I think, would be way more knowledgeable intellectually than perhaps anyone that is in this room, and perhaps we could even say than most people who are alive today. And yet Nicodemus, as much as he knew about God facts, about God's Word, he knew that there was something different about Jesus. He said it this way. He said, Master, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do the miracles that thou doest except God be with him. He knew that Jesus was the real thing because of what Jesus did. Friend, if I could boil it down as simply as I could for you here this morning, I would have you to understand that Jesus was different than anyone who had been born because, unlike everyone else, Jesus was sinless. Something that set him apart from any other man who had been born. Nicodemus, I'm sure, was aware of the virgin birth of Jesus Christ, that Jesus was not born with a physical father, that he was born of the seed of a woman, not the seed of a man, and so he was not a sinner. Nicodemus, though, was also currently, when he came and appeared to Jesus, or came to Jesus by night, he was also aware that the miracles that Jesus did set him apart. What miracles? Well, John said in the same gospel that the passage I'm referencing is in, John said that the things that Jesus did, if they were written in a book, the whole world couldn't contain the things that would be written. In other words, the miracles that Jesus did were so prolific that on a daily basis, multitudes came to him and were healed. Multitudes came to him on a daily basis and found forgiveness for sin. But there were some ones that were written as a reference point so we could understand what Jesus did. We know that Jesus turned water into wine. We know that Jesus fed 5,000 with a few loaves of bread and a couple small fishes. We know that Jesus healed a lame man and forgave his sins. We know that Jesus walked on water. We could go on and on with the miracles that we're aware that Jesus did. And Nicodemus said, obviously, only God could do that, and so you must be a representative from God. And then Jesus explained to Nicodemus, Nicodemus, you've got to be born again. Nicodemus said, I don't know how to be born again. How can a man be born when he's old? Can he go a second time in his mother's womb and be born? It's a little late for most of us, isn't it, to get born again? And so Jesus explained what he's talking about is spiritual birth. And if you haven't heard what I've said up until this point, pay attention now before we get into our text in Romans, because I want to make sure that everyone knows how to be born again. Jesus explained that spiritual things are different than physical things. The other day I was down in Miami Beach at a coffee shop with a man who was unsaved, and I was explaining the gospel to him, and the breeze was blowing the palm trees above us. And I asked him, I said, "Is it windy today?" And he said, "Yes, it is." I said, "How do you know? Can you see the wind?" And he said, "Well, I can see the trees blowing, and our napkins are blowing off the table. The wind's blowing." He could see the wind because of what it was moving. He could see, and you and I, my friend, can recognize the Spirit of God on the basis of what it moves. And you're here today actually because of the moving of the Spirit of God. God's Spirit is in every believer. Matter of fact, God's Spirit, my friend, is in this room. He's not even confined to individuals. The Bible says that where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. And so God's Spirit is in this place today. And you may be, this may be a strange place for you because of that. You may say, there's something about this room, there's something that I feel that is, you know, something that I haven't felt or experienced before. My friend, that's God's Spirit. And He's going to take God's Word today, and He's going to show you the very things that Jesus explained to Nicodemus. Jesus then told Nicodemus how to be born again, how to be born spiritually. Spiritual birth is invisible. Physical birth is visible. We understand the difference between that? Jesus explained it using the illustration of Moses with the serpent in the wilderness. And that story is one that perhaps most of us are familiar with, but maybe not all. When Moses was leading the children of Israel out of Egypt in the wilderness, they complained against Moses, they complained against God, and God sent a judgment of poisonous vipers. Snakes that were so poisonous that we understand that when they bit someone, they died. I've read up on them, and people that think that they know what these vipers were believe that their venom was so poisonous that when you were bitten, you could literally feel the venom coursing through your veins and felt as though you were on fire until you died. And people were dying. They repented because they recognized it was wrong for them to complain against God, to complain against Moses. And God gave them a remedy. He told Moses to form a serpent out of brass and to erect it on a snake in the middle of the camp of the Israelites. And any time a person was bitten by the poisonous viper, if they would look at that snake, then they could live. And the scriptural account says that the people that looked at the serpent on the pole lived, and those who did not died. Now, my question, and everybody's question ought to be, what was the difference? What is it about a brass serpent that has the ability to heal a person? And the answer to that question is not a thing in the world. We see that sign, don't we, on ambulances and on doctor's offices and so forth? And I think most of the people who use that sign as a sign of healing don't even know what it is. What was it about that serpent in the wilderness that later a godly king had to destroy because people worshipped it instead of God? What was it about it that healed? My friend, faith. Faith. Because people who looked at it believed God, and people who refused to believe in God. And Jesus said, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever, a word that means anyone, whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have eternal life. In that verse, most of us know, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. And my friend, it happened to me when I was a child. I realized that I was bitten by the serpent of sin, and that if I had died in my sin, I would have died as God's enemy and have had the consequential or subsequent reward of being God's enemy. And I realized that Jesus died in my place, God's perfect Son, and I looked to Jesus. I prayed a prayer. It was just words. I can't remember the exact words, but I basically said, God, I want Jesus to save me. And He did. His Spirit came into my life, into my heart, and God did something that was invisible, that has visibly changed my life. And that could be you as well this morning. Matter of fact, don't even wait till the end of the service if that's a prayer you need to pray. God, I want Jesus to be my Savior. God will save you right where you're sitting at. He knows the prayer. He knows the desire of your heart, and He will be gloriously saved. And then everything we're going to preach now that I'm finished with my introduction will make a lot more sense. I feel like I should pray and open, but you know, you got to explain the gospel, don't you, on Sunday morning? Yeah. People need to hear the gospel. Now, friend, here we are in Romans chapter 11. We've seen a couple of themes as we've studied through Romans. One of the themes that we've seen, first of all, is the theme of Jews and Greeks. Matter of fact, one of the verses a lot of people know in Romans, right? Romans 1:16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth." Say the next part with me, will you, please?
The Jew first,
and also to the Greeks. That's a theme that is found all the way through Romans, And now Paul is diving into that theme very, very handily. Now, it's hard for us to relate, actually, to the church at Rome. It's a little tough for us. And the reason it's difficult is because when each person in this room was physically born, there were churches all around the world. There were probably, for most of us, churches in our neighborhood, or for many of us, we grew up in church. And so the church was no strange thing, it was no new thing. That's true, isn't it? Now, church is a generic term that God's Word defines what a church is. And I understand that people define church as things other than what the Bible says it is. Don't you? You understand what I'm saying? For instance, sometimes when we knock on doors, we'll have people say something like, well, I don't need to come to church. This is what somebody said a while back. I got a church in me, is what a guy told us. I got a church in me. Well, I don't know what he thinks church is, but the word church is a word that means gathering or called out ones gathering together. And so I wonder what was going on inside of the poor fellow. But the fact of the matter is that he didn't have a church in him. He had his definition of some kind of a spiritual experience that he equated to church. My friend, church is not a spiritual experience. A church is actually the way that God today is working through the world. He's working through His church. And before Jesus ascended into heaven after the resurrection, when He died on the cross, was buried, and rose again, after He was resurrected, Jesus, really His last words to His disciples were about His church. Before He went to the cross, Jesus explained that He was going to build His church. He said, on this rock, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And so here today, we are where? What are we doing today? We're churching, right? We're assembling together. We are the local assembly, the church, this morning. And so it's not really a strange thing to most of us, and because it's not a strange thing, we don't think so much about it. But can you imagine what it must have been like for the Jews and the Gentiles in the first century at the church? There hadn't been one before. Today, if I want to know, say somebody has a question, Pastor, what's a pastor? Well, I can go to the Bible and I can read about it. I can read about the offices in the church. If I want to know what a church is, I can go to the Scripture and read about it. But keep in mind, Romans hadn't been written when Paul was writing Romans. And the real question they had really would boil down to this. God had been working for a good period of time through Israel. I mean, He'd done miracles in Israel, through Israel. His temple was in Jerusalem, and God had visibly, physically dwelt in the temple at Jerusalem. And so God had worked through a nation of people, Israel. And the question really would be for the Jews who are part of this church at Rome, and for the Gentiles, if God's working through the church, then what about Israel? Right? That's the real question. Don't you have the same question sometimes? I think sometimes Christians, we can kind of get dispensationally confused. I don't mean to use words to confuse people. A dispensation simply means God dispensing Himself or working at a different time a certain way. The gospel's always been the same. It's always been through faith. And that's one of the things that was established early on in Romans. But most people, when they study Romans, they know a couple verses, but they don't really understand the full context. First, in Romans, we saw in the first several chapters the gospel and the simplicity of it. First of all, we saw that every person is accountable to receive Jesus as their Savior. The Jews are responsible because they have the Word of God. The Gentiles are responsible because they have God's law written in their hearts. And every person knows there's a God, we saw in Romans chapter 1. Every person knows, just from creation, they know that not only is there a God, but they know that the word Godhead, which is the word we use for Trinity, is they even know the kind of a God that is. It is an all-knowing, all-supreme, omnipotent, and so forth God. And so creation itself, I talked to somebody this last week that said, I don't know whether there's a God or not. I said, yeah, actually you do. Person was a sailor. I worked on boats. I said, you ever been out in the morning when the water's calm? And you ever looked out on the water and just looked around you and just saw all the activity and all the amazing things? I mean, it's just beautiful sometimes just to get out on the water. I've been out on the water when literally the sun is setting, the water is calm, you can look off this way and there's a rainstorm, a thunderstorm, and you can look over here and see a storm, and you see the vividness of the colors, and you see the movement in the water, just see things, you think, only God could have made this. You know, every person knows that. Every person has been in a place where they've spiritually realized, not only is this created by I, also am created by God. And so Paul explains that. And explains that every person is responsible to receive Jesus because of what they know in their hearts. Listen, you don't have to read a book that'll prove to you there's a God. God put it in your heart to know there's a God, and that's enough. It's enough for you to believe on Him, to receive Him. Then we saw Paul really dealing with the matter of the law, because here you have a church that's mixed between Jews and Gentiles, and they're really struggling with this concept of what is the meaning or the importance of the law that has been so important to Israel for so many years. Is righteousness by the law? And we saw the best illustration that Paul gave that righteousness doesn't come from the law, using the illustration of Abraham. Because the Bible says in Genesis 15 that Abraham believed God and his faith was counted for righteousness. So if Abraham believed God and had righteousness by faith, did Abraham come before or after Moses' law was given?
Before.
So if Abraham was righteous before the law, is it the law that brings righteousness? No, we saw then the purpose of the law, that the law helps to make sin exceeding sinful. Paul put it this way. He said, for until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no law. He said, nevertheless, from death reigned from Adam until Moses. So people died before there was a law, and they died because of sin. Because God said that the soul that sinneth, it shall die. So people died before the law, but when they had the law, they knew why they were dying. Do you understand that? In other words, it wasn't that they didn't know they were sinners, but according to Paul, he said the law helps us to understand specifics about sin. And that's a help to us, isn't it? By the way, Christian, you ought to understand that if all Scripture is given by inspiration of God is profitable, then you and I ought to be interested in what God's law says is sin. A Christian ought to be a student of the law. Not because we think that we can have it fulfill or perform righteousness in us, but simply because we understand that the law shows us what sin is. And if you're concerned about holiness and righteousness, and you've received Jesus by faith, and you're God's child, you ought to be concerned about sin. You ought to want it in your life. Okay, so now we've moved into a portion of Scripture that deals specifically with Israel. The last 2 weeks, I'm still in my introduction, but I'm going to get through my message fast. I know you folks are just frightened to death, and you have good reason to be, by the way. I'd be terrified as well. The last couple of weeks, then, we've seen Paul kind of defend himself. See, Paul's a little bit of an outsider with Israel. Before Paul got saved, he was a serious insider. He was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. We saw in Sunday school class this morning his description of himself in Philippians. And he was a devoted Pharisee, but he was so devoted that he hated anything that he saw as something that would circumvent or harm Judaism as he knew it. And so he was so devoted in his spirituality that he killed Christians. And so he would have been very well accepted among the Jews and very unaccepted by the Christians. But when he became a believer, God called him specifically to be an apostle to the Gentiles. And now as he's writing, explaining to this church at Rome that, hey, the law doesn't save, there's a bit of an edginess, if you will, to the Jewish church there. They're feeling a little bit slighted by Paul, as though he's betrayed them, as though he's left them, and now he's an apostle to the Gentiles, and so he's against them, and it isn't so at all. And so in chapter 9, he begins his argument by saying, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me a witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart, for my kinsmen, my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. He said, I would, if I could, I would allow or account myself, I would be willing to be accursed from Christ for my brethren. Paul said literally, and I'm not using slang this morning, Paul said literally, I would go to hell if Israel could go to heaven. In other words, if my love for Israel could cause them to turn to God in belief, I'd go to hell for it. My friend, I'll be as honest as I possibly can with you this morning. There are individuals that I love, I feel like, with all my heart, and yet I cannot say I'd go to hell so that they could be saved. I want to say that I could, but when I understand what eternity is, when I understand what God's wrath is, and when I understand what judgment is, I'm terrified of hell. And I'd be terrified to go there for all of eternity, but Paul said, I love Israel enough. So he's helping the Jews and the church to understand, hey, listen, you may feel as though you're being cast aside or as though you're unimportant or as though I'm against you. But let me just tell you something. I love the Jews enough, I'd go to hell if they could be saved. And then in chapter 10, Paul explained why Israel is lost. That's what we looked at last week. He said they're not lost. Israel is not lost because of zeal. He said they have a zeal, but they have a zeal not according to knowledge. So he said they're lost, but it's not because of being devout or being devoted. They're very devoted to their religion, but he went on to say it's not for lack of zeal, but it's because they have a high view of their laws, their man-made righteousness, and they have a low view of God's righteousness. They're going about to establish their own righteousness, and they don't have any kind of a regard at all for the fact that God is holy. So Israel's going to hell, not because of zeal, but they are going to hell because they think they're righteous and they think God's evil. He said they're going to hell because of the law of righteousness. And it said they're not lost because they have not believed, they haven't heard the gospel. He went on to say as well, they're not lost because they did not know. They do know. And he said, it's not because God hasn't reached out to them. And that's the verse right before our text today. To Israel, he saith, all day long I've stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and gainsaying people. So friend, God wants the church to realize that he has not rejected Israel because of anything on his part. He's rejected them because of unbelief. If we could read this morning Deuteronomy 4, and we cannot, we would see when God gave his law to Moses, we would see one of the things that God showed them was that you're going to go into the land, I'm going to give you this land, and yet you're going to worship idols and you're going to reject me. And so because of that, I'm going to give the gospel to other nations. Now, I want to look at a couple of important points this morning in Romans 11. It won't take long. I'm being truthful with you. Of course, my not long and your not long may be a little different in time frame. But hey, we didn't have special music this morning, so I saved you guys like 2 minutes. So everybody, you know, should be thankful for that. Okay. Look in your Bible if you're in Romans 11. Look to verse 2. God hath not cast away his people, which he foreknew. Watch ye not what the scripture saith of Elias, how he maketh intercession to God against Israel, saying, Lord, they've killed thy prophets and digged down thine altars, and I'm left alone, and they seek my life. But what saith the answer of God unto him? By the way, if you're looking for cross-references for this, it'd be 1 Kings 18:22, and then the cross-reference for verse 4 would be 1 Kings 19:8. But what saith the answer of God unto him? I've reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. So the question is, if God is working through the church, then what of Israel? Is God finished with Israel? Has Israel disappeared? Is the church and Israel, are they the same? These are questions we have, aren't they? What is Israel? What is the church? Well, God said, I'm not done with Israel, but I want you to understand that many Israelites are saved. Christian, if I could hammer this home, this is, I think, one of the greatest distractions in Christianity, and I think one of the reasons that Jewish ministry is so ineffective oftentimes. And I don't mean to be critical this morning, and I hope you don't take this the wrong way, but many, many times we treat God's people, national Israel, as though salvation for them is different than it is for anyone else. You understand what I'm saying here this morning? For instance, I've had good believers, and I'm not against this, don't misunderstand me, but I've had good individuals who love the Lord and love the Jewish people come and explain to me how to preach the gospel to Israel from the Old Testament of the Scripture. Sometimes they'll call it the Isaiah Trail instead of the Romans Road. They'll preach through Isaiah, and they always have a unique, special approach for how to preach the gospel to the Jews. Now, I don't mean to discredit anybody, and I understand that people get saved by the grace of God. A lot of different ways they come to a saving knowledge of Christ only by faith. But I just want you to understand something. Jews get saved the same as anybody else does. Yeah, I guess we know that we have a large Jewish population in South Florida, don't we? Miami Beach, where our other church is more than 60% Jewish. And it used to be. It isn't now. It's 30-something percent. So 1 in 3 people you meet is Jewish, is Israeli. You know what I found out about Jewish people in the gospel? That I either reject it or they receive it the same as anyone else. I remember the first time it occurred to me, and I practiced it. I remember being at a mall when I was young in the ministry in Boca Raton, and being at Town Center Mall, and I handed tracts to some people, and they said, I'm Jewish. And it occurred to me that made no difference at all to God. I said, you still need to be saved. I said, but you still need to be saved. And they said, oh. And I shared the gospel with them, and they got saved. And I thought, you know, they got saved just like anybody else does. And it's so silly, isn't it, that we try to appeal to people almost as though the gospel were a different gospel to God's people, the Jews. Let me remind you about something in the church. Where did the church, first church begin? Jerusalem. Were they Gentiles? The church didn't begin in Rome, folks. It began in Jerusalem, and the first people who were born again were Jews. And if anybody understood the whosoever will salvation and gospel, it was the Jews. Who did God use to write the majority ethnically or nationally of the New Testament of the Scripture? Yeah, somebody said Paul. Yeah, God used Paul a lot, but Jews, right? So how are Jews saved? What gospel do we preach to the Jews? The same gospel as anyone else. We almost in every service have individuals that nationally are Jewish, but are born the same as anybody else. In all of our churches, actually, both at Marathon and Miami Beach and Fort Lauderdale, and people are, hey, how'd you get saved? Same way anyone does. What did it have to do with being Jewish? Well, God was the God of the Israel, and God's the God of the church, but the gospel, my friend, is the gospel that is preached in the scripture, and it's simply preached, simply explained, and God said to, or God's word from Paul to the church at Rome was, a lot of Jews are saved. A lot of Jews are believers. Now, why is it that we don't know how many Jews are part of the church? Well, my friend, if your identity becomes in Jesus Christ, as we saw when the, remember in Acts, when the Gentiles got saved and then the Holy Spirit's power came in them and was witnessed by the apostles, and they saw, hey, they have the same Holy Spirit living in them as the Jews do. And the Bible says that the believers were called Jews first at Antioch. They were called Jews first. Thanks, Charlie. They were called Christians first at Antioch. Why was it that they were called Christians? Well, instead of Christianity, quote, being a sect of Judaism, its identity became Jesus instead of Judaism. And I have a problem, friend. I'm not here to gripe or complain or talk out about anything or anyone. But Messianic Judaism today is paganism. You study Judaism, look at Judaism in the Scripture, and you recognize that what is practiced by God's people, whom He greatly loves, according to the flesh, Israel today, Judaism is not found in the Scripture. It's made up. It's a man-made pagan religion. I have a real problem, and you ought to as well, if you're a discerning Christian, with trying to convert the church to Judaism. We're telling people who are Jewish believers that they still have their identity with Judaism instead of with Jesus Christ. And so, if you're involved with, quote, Messianic ministry, I have no problem with the gospel, with Jesus being called the Messiah and so forth. But my friend, Jesus today is working not through Israel. He's working through the church. Yeah. He's working through the church. And I'm not ranting when I say that if God makes much of it, we ought to as well. Amen. Listen, as a believer, if you want to know what God is doing and what God is working through, He told us. He said, I'm going to establish my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And so God is big into His church, if you don't mind me saying so. And Jesus loves it a lot, and it's what God is doing, what God is about. And if you want to find where God is and where God is working, you'll find it in a church that defines itself God's way. And so God is trying to help the church at Rome here now to realize, to understand something that is vitally important. And that is, if you're going to hold on to your Jewishness, you're going to hold on to your Judaism, it's the same as holding on to paganism. And God wanted the church, though, in case they should feel slighted as though, well, you know, God's rejected Israel, God doesn't save Jews. He said, hey, you know, Elijah said the same thing. God, I only alone am left. And God said, hey, Elijah, I have 7,000 people who haven't bowed the knee to Baal. Amen. And if you buy into the Jews don't hear the gospel, then you have literally cut your legs out from under yourself when you preach the gospel to the Jews. When somebody tells me, oh, I'm Jewish, I can't hear the gospel, I say, yes, you can. Don't you understand that the gospel came from the Jews? Don't you understand that Jesus was a Jew? Don't you know? Hey, the rabbis tell you you can't listen, but yes, you can. You can hear it. Why? Because God is the God of all living, and it has nothing to do with being a Jew not being able to receive the gospel. Listen, Jews are a great part of the church today, and perhaps more so than we even know. I think many times because of finding our identity in Jesus, we lose our physical identity with Israel. And that's okay with God because He's keeping track of all that. You know that? God knows who's who and what's what, and He understands those who are believing. That's our first point today. We only have like 6 points. That's one. So, no, not really. Really, I have a couple of points I want to make today. The first one would be that Jews are part of the church. And Paul is sort of saying to the church at Rome, he's saying, hey guys, if Jews don't get saved, then what am I and what are you? It's his first point. It's an important point, isn't it? What is Israel today? Is God working through Israel? And the answer is God's working through the church today, but Jews get saved and are part of the church today. If you're Jewish and you're a believer, you need to find your identity in Jesus, not in a nation, today. Okay, we won't say much more about that for sake of time this morning. Secondly, I'd like to look down at verse 7. Here's the question, what then? Israel hath not obtained that which he seeketh for, but the election hath obtained it, and the rest were blinded. Okay, this word election is not something to stumble over. It means exactly what it says. We saw a couple weeks ago what the word foreknowledge means. It means God knows something before. But we saw the foreknowledge and predestination are not the same word. A lot of people get messed up doctrinally. It's not complicated. God, foreknowledge simply means God knows everything, and He knows it before it happens. Is everybody okay with that this morning? Everybody okay with God's foreknowledge? Predestination, though, in Romans chapter 8, simply says that every person who has come to Jesus by faith is predestinated to be conformed to Jesus. Predestinated to be conformed to the image of His Son. In other words, the outcome of every Christian is that one day you'll be exactly like your Savior. That's predestination in the Scripture. You can read it and study it, and if you put it in its context, it's not complicated. It's not the same word as foreknowledge. And then individuals take the word election, and they kind of mix all three of these words. Foreknowledge, election, and predestination, and they make it as though God is the elector of the saved, and He is the elector of the lost. In other words, God chooses who will be saved, who will be lost. My friend, can we understand here in the context of Israel, God is talking about a national people that are set apart to bear a testimony of His name, and whom, as we're studying even Revelation and where we'll be this evening, God has a future plan with? That's what the final verse we read today was, "So all Israel shall be saved." God's going to work again through Israel, but what and how is God working today? That's the question. Well, God's working through His church. Okay, so verse 7, the Bible says, "What then? Israel hath not obtained that which he seeketh for, but the election hath obtained it, and the rest were blinded." Why is a person blinded? Unbelief. Look at verse 20. "Well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith, be not high-minded, but fear." Let me ask you a question. Belief. Is it a choice, or is it a response? You understand the question? Believing something, is it a choice or is it a response? You ever had somebody say, "I wish I could believe that"? That is the most disingenuous statement there possibly could be. If you want to believe something, you can, actually. And to prove it, just be honest about yourself sometimes. Have you ever believed something in spite of the facts? You ever just believe something in spite of the facts? I was going to invoke this past Super Bowl, but I thought it's a little too near for some people who might be a little sore about it. So we won't talk about that. Let me think of something else. Tom Brady. Who's going to beat Tom Brady, right? In the Super Bowl. Okay, we're done. All right. But some people just believe, right? I mean, they may be from Atlanta, and they still believe in their sports teams. And so it's a good illustration that people make a choice, right? It doesn't have anything to do with the facts. It doesn't have anything to do with ability. You ever met somebody who believes something about you that wasn't true? Have you? I think all of us have. I mean, that hurts, doesn't it? Somebody believes something about you that wasn't true, and the frustrating thing about it was that facts had nothing to do with it. I mean, if facts had anything to do with it, you could simply present the facts, and then they'd believe the truth. But they believed what they wanted to. And we all do that, actually, don't we? So unbelief is the same thing. If a person won't believe, it's a choice of the will. The very word belief, the very word faith, has to do with the choice of the will. And so why is it that Israel is not part of the elect? Why is it that all of Israel, nationally, is not saved? Unbelief. It's a choice. But it is not a national choice. A lot of Israel have believed, and that's the illustration in Romans chapter 10. Paul said, "You've believed, you Jewish church, you Jewish believers at Rome, and I've believed, so we've believed, so Jews believe the gospel, don't they?" But isn't that liberating? Isn't that liberating when it comes to preaching the gospel to the Jews? My friend, why don't we spend more time praying for the power of the Holy Spirit and for an open door? And why don't we spend more time getting to know God's Word and understanding how to explain the gospel simply and directly? That's what will help people get saved. Not being able to have an argument or some kind of a presentation to somebody on the basis of their background. Okay, moving forward. Some Jews get saved, or many Jews get saved. And now we see the reason Israel is blind. Look at verse 11, will you please? Verse 10. "Let their eyes be darkened, that they may not see, and bow down their back alway." This is quoting David in Psalm 69. "I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid, but rather through their fall, salvation is come to the Gentiles, unto the Gentiles, for to provoke them to jealousy." Now you could reference this before it ever happened. It was mentioned in Deuteronomy 32. In other words, God has allowed Israel to be in unbelief, and he has used it literally to help the Gentiles to realize, man, that's a good God, we ought to believe in him. It's painful sometimes, isn't it, to see a good person love someone and have them not reciprocate? You ever see a good guy who loves a girl and she just doesn't love him back? Maybe it's his wife or something like that. You ever see a lady and she loves someone and they don't love them back? And you think, man, what a great person. Why don't you reciprocate their love? And some people think, man, if I only had that opportunity, I'd take it. And as nationally Israel rebelled against their God, turned to idols, turned to other nations instead of turning to God, the other nations looked and said, if I had a God like that, I'd believe in him. And the Gentiles got saved. They saw Jesus. They saw the gospel. Can you imagine what it must have been like to be that woman at the well of Samaria when Jesus came and sat down there and he asked her to draw water? And she said, you're a Jew. Why are you asking water from me? I'm a Samaritan. And she started to talk about worship. And she said, our fathers say we can worship in the mountains. And the Jews say we have to worship in Jerusalem. And Jesus said, well, the Jews are right about that. They that worship God must worship him in spirit and in truth. But if you knew who you were talking to, you could ask him and he'd give you living water. And you know the testimony was that woman went into the town and she said, come see a man that told me everything I ever did. And the whole town came out, and the Bible testimony, the gospel testimony of it, is that the town of Samaria got saved. Everybody did. And they were kind of outcasts. They were Jewish, and they were ethnically Jewish, but they also had some, they were outcast Jewishly. And when they found out that God would save them, man, they took the chance. He said, man, I want Jesus. My friend, we don't have time this morning to go all the way through the message that I want to preach. But let me just say this. God loves you very much. God hasn't cast away Israel. They haven't stumbled. They haven't fallen. So, because we're special, or they haven't fallen in a way that they cannot recover. God's people, Israel, can always be saved. But do you realize that we live in a day and age of opportunity? We live in a day and age of chance. God is working today through the church, and the church is ever so inclusive of anyone who will call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. See, today we try to make inclusive meaning about the world, but now actually it's inclusive of anyone who's about Jesus Christ. You may be here this morning, and you may have some questions about God and Israel and what God is doing. You can understand from reading the rest of the Scripture that there's going to come a day when all Israel is going to be saved. Matter of fact, there's coming a day soon. I want to warn you, Christian, there's a coming a day when Jesus is going to come and he's going to take his church out of this world. He's going to take his saints. And when that happens, God will no longer be working through the church. And friend, understand, when God is no longer working through the church, this age of the Gentiles, as it is called, this day of great opportunity, will not be what it is now. You know, sometimes I thought, man, it would be really neat if I were born in the day that Jesus came. Anybody ever like to have seen the miracles of Jesus firsthand?
Yeah.
I think I would, wouldn't you? That'd be kind of neat. I just want to tell you something. I'm born in the church age, and never in the history of time have things been better than they are today with regard to God and His moving among men. You say, Pastor, what do you mean? Well, God's Spirit is in this world, and God's Holy Spirit is speaking to men right now. He indwells believers. He saves them. He sanctifies them. He seals them. Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord can be saved. We live in a day of opportunity. Listen, we're supposed to be laboring for a heavenly reward, and we have the opportunity to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ today. We also live in a day that Jesus' coming is closer than it's ever been. My friend, I want Jesus to come soon, don't you? I want to preach the gospel. I want to have eternal reward, but I do say, even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly. I want Jesus to come. The judgment's coming when Jesus does come. When Jesus takes his church out of this world, he's going to work in the world events that are going to cause Israel to turn to him and be sanctified. And when God does that, my friend, it's going to be rough. It's going to be tough living in that time. And so I say I'm glad to be alive today. But the reason I'm glad to be alive today is because I know Jesus. And my question and conclusion this morning is, do you? Do you know Jesus as your Savior? You're here this morning, you don't know Jesus as your Savior. A lot of spiritual events, a lot of the world events can be kind of confusing to you. But my friend, if I didn't know Jesus as my Savior, they'd be more than confusing. They'd be terrifying. If you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, you could simply just pray the prayer I mentioned earlier today. It's not words. It's not vain repetition. It's from your heart and say, God, I know I'm a sinner. I know Jesus died for my sins, and I'm asking you to save me. I want to be part of your plan. I want to be part of your church. And the Bible says, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. God will save you for it. You may be a Christian, you may be here, and sometimes I think we as believers get caught up in theological fads, don't we? I think many times Christians are more interested in what God is doing in Tel Aviv than we are with what God is doing in the church. You may think, you know, you may be spending all your time trying to figure out what God's going to do someday in Israel. And I want to remind you that today God isn't working with Israel. Today God's working with His church. And if Israel wants to get with God, they get with His program, His church. And sometimes I believe we're very, very guilty of not making much of what God makes much of and making very little of the same. And for the believers that are here today, I would encourage you, would you make much of the gospel? Would you make much of Christ's church? Would you stay focused on, would you understand that, hey, listen, Jews get saved, but they get saved through the church. And I got saved, and today I'm saved, and I'm part of Christ's church. If you'll do that, I believe that God will use that to help your focus, and help you to be more effective as a believer. To be more effective in preaching the gospel, and to know how you're supposed to live. You know, most Christians really just struggle with this matter of God's will, don't they? Well, it's sad, isn't it? Many believers struggle. Say, I don't know what God wants in my life. My friend, if you know what God's doing, you know what He wants. He wants us to be part of His church. Father, thank You for what You've taught us from Your Word this morning. And I just ask that as we have our invitation now, Lord, in so many ways I feel like such a weak vessel to convey Your Word. And so I ask for Your Spirit to make up for the things that perhaps I would have said if I had time or that I could have said. And rather, Father, we trust You now to bless and to move in this invitation. Before I finish my prayer and before everyone opens their eyes, would you please do me the favor of keeping your head bowed and your eyes closed while I explain the invitation? The invitation is a time at the end of our service when we invite you, if God's spoken to you, to not leave without having responded to Him. So it's simply the word invitation simply means invite, and we're inviting you now to say yes, Lord, to whatever it is that God has said to you. If God's spoken to you today, maybe it's a matter of clarity. Maybe it is that you've been a little distracted by what God is doing today and how He's working in this world. Could today, if God's spoken to you about that, could you, during the invitation, just say, yes, Lord? You know what, God, I want to be part of Your plan. I want to be part of Your program. Could be that you're here this morning and you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior. I've asked Brother Taj to stand in the back during the invitation. He's standing back there with the Bible in his hand. Because if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, you could respond to the invitation right now, and you could pray and trust Jesus to be your Savior. And so, while we open our hymns, and after I finish this prayer and we sing, we would invite every person to respond to the invitation. I'm not going to ask every person here to come forward. I believe you can do business with the Lord right where you're at. So maybe instead of standing and singing, you could remain seated and go to the Lord in prayer and commit the matters that God's spoken to your heart about. If you're here today, though, and you'd like to be born again, maybe you could motion to me during the invitation, and I could come to you and have somebody open a Bible and help you. Or you could respond by asking Brother Taj or someone else to pray with you. We want God to have His way in the invitation, so we'll ask Him for that now. Father, we ask that You would please bless and move in the invitation. We pray in Jesus' name. If you would stand to your feet, if you're physically able to do so, and open to page 125, I want to sing the song, Jesus Paid It All. We sang it in our service this morning. I'd like to sing it again. While we sing, if God's spoken to you and you need to respond, feel free to do so during the time of the invitation this morning. Jesus Paid It All, page 125.